Good morning, Tennessee Valley. Welcome back to this Friday morning.
The Friday before Father's Day.
Oh, important day for you, James.
Very important day. You have 44 hours approximately to go out and make sure that you have a gift.
The perfect gift?
Yes. It don't have to be perfect. There's many of them.
A new tie?
I don't know. Yeah, a new tie. New shirts. I want some new shirts.
Shirts.
Yeah,
you want new shirts. Hint, hint.
Hint, hint. Yeah. But it is. It's the Friday before Father's Day. This is Father's Day weekend. I'm sure there's going to be some traveling, people coming and going to the fathers, coming, mm-hmm. you know, people coming in to see their fathers. And be safe. Be safe.
Right.
And everyone up north, you know, if you're traveling north, be even safer because they've got some crazy thunderstorms going up. They even got some kind of name for it now.
Right.
And, you know, everyone up there was saying, I saw friends of ours, family members of ours posting that, you know, it wasn't as severe as they thought it was going to be, you know, the mm-hmm. 100 mile an hour winds, but they said it was, you know, pretty different, you know, than normal. I mean, it was kind of the lightning was different, they said, than normal storms, and the wind was different, but not as bad.
Right.
I don't think they've got it all yet, but they were saying that, you know, the rain was coming down sideways in some areas.
I could definitely tell a difference in this one.
So if you're traveling north, then be safe, watch the weather, you know, get on the Weather Channel or the weather.com and check out, you know, where you're traveling to for Father's Day. Be safe, make sure that you arrive there safely. And when you travel back home, you know, ensure that you're safe and everything.
Safe
so,
again, right.
Yeah, 44 hours approximately. That would be about midnight on Father's Day, you know, lead into Father's Day to get a gift, you know, last minute cards. You know, that's what printers, you know, computers and printers are nice nowadays. You don't have to worry about it. 11 o'clock Saturday night, you say, oh, no, I didn't get a card. Go print one out. It makes it look so much better than, you know, crayon and construction paper.
I was going to say, what about just getting a box of crayons and a scrap piece of paper?
I can't get away
that
with that
work.
Anymore. No, I can't get away with that anymore. My dad knows me too well. Are you going to hold a card like a Mother's Day card? Let me, I hold the pen, you move the card
move
around.
Move the card around, yeah. right.
That's what she said she did. I signed it.
You did, actually.
But I got to call my father. I mean, it was his birthday last week,
the
6th.
Yeah.
And 80 years old. Mm-hmm. Probably still acts like he's about 60. Acts like he's about 55, 60 still. Still up, moving around, getting
mentally
around.
Mentally probably a little younger. He's still a kid at heart.
Yeah, he's still a kid. He does all the stuff he does, tricks, and still tricks on, you know, does tricks with me, with Simon. Mm-hmm. Simon, when he's around Simon, Simon gets to see what I got to, you know, I had to go through as a kid, you know, doing the saw, cutting the saw, and then grabbing your leg, you know, I still do that. I do it to
Simon.
Teaching
you how to run the electric as he grabs you.
Yeah, I did that to him. He used to run electric for us in outside in the shed, and he always did it to me. He's always saying, like, touch these two wires, and I touch him, and he'd grab me. You know, I did it to him, and scared him. He almost didn't make 80. I scared
Thanks
him well
you,
enough, he
huh?
jumped. And he said, did you do that to me? I said, Dad, you've done that to me years, plenty of times.
Right.
Tell me to touch that right there, and I touch it, and he shocked me or grabbed me and stuff. So I did it to him. He just wasn't expecting it.
It wasn't quite as funny when it was on him.
So happy Father's Day to all the fathers out there.
That's right.
And kids, make sure that you call your father. Talk to him. If you're mad at him, call him anyway. If he's mad at you, call him anyway.
Visit.
Yeah. Leave an answer machine. I mean, you know, you can get a lot of messages on the voice messages.
Keep hanging up.
Keep hanging up, call him back. You can get like 10 messages in about, maybe it takes about... Yeah, about 15, 20
You've
minutes.
You've done it. You know.
Yeah, I have. We've had it done to us.
Right.
So, guests on the show today?
Barry and Monica Cochran from LF Deerdorf and Sons. Interesting.
They've got a lot of interesting things to talk about.
Very neat.
And I don't want to steal none of the thunder.
No.
And so we'll let them talk about that.
Very
we have some show notes to go over and everything.
Right.
And
We'll save that for later.
Right. We'll give most of the show to our guests today. And I guess what we could do is just go to commercial break, and we'll come back here with our first guest.
Sure.
Town Americana, where trucks are big and bold, and a handshake is firm, and your word is gold. Don Lefford Chevy Buick GMC in Athens is a $2,000 drive. Maybe you're coming from here or here. Doesn't matter. Buying a truck from Don Lefford in Athens will save you at least $2,000. Don Lefford Chevy Buick GMC in Athens, a $2,000 drive worth making.
I'll take that drive every time.
At Crawford Pharmacy, we offer custom compounding. Our pharmacists are known for their attention to detail and unique expertise. So visit us at 2260 Chambliss Avenue, Cleveland, Tennessee. For personal assistance, walk right in or come up to our convenient drive-thru. Crawford Pharmacy, serving our community one person at a time.
Kyle Motors, 802 20th Street Southeast in Cleveland, is the place to find quality pre-owned cars and trucks. Kyle offers on-the-spot financing on all vehicles on the lot. Each pre-owned vehicle goes through a complete inspection to make sure each car and truck meets the Kyle Motors standard. Warranty and extended warranties available on all vehicles. Kyle Motors will sell you a car or truck that you will be proud to drive for many years to come. See Tony, Bill, Dale, James, or David and let them put you in your next quality pre-owned vehicle. Kyle Motors, 802 20th Street Southeast, phone 790-7100.
Are you having trouble filing for disability?
Seems no one is concerned about your pain, the waiting, the denials.
While some representatives will meet with you in court, we will meet with you now to discuss your plan. We'll review with you the same file that the judges will see. Call us now, Social Security Law Center at Logan Thompson.
You're entitled to better.
This segment of Tennessee Valley This Morning is brought to you by Crown Chrysler Dodge Jeep and Ram, located at 511 South Lee Highway in Cleveland and 2120 Chapman Road, Chattanooga. For your next new or previously owned vehicle, make it Crown Chrysler Dodge Jeep and Ram, the better way to buy.
Welcome back, folks, and we're here with our first guests, Barry and Monica Cochran from LF Deerdorf & Sons Cameras, and welcome to the show today.
Thank you very much.
They're actually our neighbors in the incubator.
That's right.
Neighbors in the incubator, right there, and we knock on the wall, right there, I mean, that close. They're our actual neighbors.
You know, we can. Sometimes we can hear them tap in there. Working, yes.
And I'm sure they can hear us over there.
I'm sure they hear our
run copies. But we're glad to have you here today, this morning, on for the show, and let's talk about cameras.
Well, we are LF Deerdorf & Sons Incorporated, and we manufacture, we repair, and we refurbish cameras like this. Now, to most folks, you would look at this and think of it as an antique, something that goes back to the Civil War, perhaps. And the design really does go back to the Civil War. But what these are known as, generically, is large format cameras. They're called large format cameras because they use film, not digital, for capturing the image. And the size of the glass you see here is 8x10 inch. That's the actual size of the negative that this camera makes. And other cameras that we manufacture make negatives that are as small as 4x5 inch, as large as 16x20 inch. Okay. And so there are two reasons people use large format. One is that when you use film instead of digital, you receive an image that has tremendous amount of detail. And then the second reason you use cameras like this is that, as you see, it has a bellows, and that allows the camera to tilt and swing and twist and contort, and that creates different effects on the film.
Okay. Now, the history, you talked about earlier, you have a birthday coming up, correct?
In 3 years, in 2016, the company will be 100 years old. The reason why we know this is because when we bought the company, we wound up with everything. And so we were opening up a crate, and it had what I would term a 1940 PowerPoint. And that is, somebody had hand-painted for like a poster effect. When they would go to conferences or shows, camera shows, they could put this up. And this was obviously a camera show for the Chicago area, and believe it or not, it was for law enforcement. And on the title, the top piece of this, it says LF Deerdorf & Sons Incorporated, because back then everybody incorporated, since 1916. So that means that the company, Laban Fitzgerald Deerdorf, had his company going with his three sons in 1916. So 2016 will be the 100-year anniversary.
Okay. Now, you guys had bought the company out, and it had kind of, I guess, not, I don't want to say died out, but it had kind of slowed down to a point where I mean,
there hadn't been any new cameras since 1991. And so the company had effectively been dormant for about 20 years. Mm-hmm. And then we purchased the company from the estate of the last surviving family member. And it was quite a undertaking to get all the inventory, the parts, the tooling, the equipment down from Indiana, where we purchased the company. But going back to the history a little bit, people have seen images taken with Deerdorf cameras and perhaps not realized it. Deerdorfs have been in use with so many different parts of the world. Almost all the catalog photography in the Sears Roebuck catalog, JCPenney, Montgomery Ward's, were taken with 8x10 Deerdorfs just like this. And so in a Sears catalog, if you had a picture of a tool set and the picture may only be 2 inches by 3 inches, it was still probably taken originally with a camera like this on 8x10 film, and then actually reduced instead of enlarged, just to enhance the amount of detail all the more. Pictures of Marilyn Monroe from the days of Look magazine were taken with Deerdorf camera.
In fact, the gentleman who took her picture,
Douglas Kirkland.
His name's Douglas Kirkland, and he purchased last year from us a new one. But he has his original Deerdorf. He sent it to us. We had to do a little repair on it. So a lot of the famous Hollywood celebrities, he has taken their picture with a Deerdorf. And then to show the opposite effect, on the beaches of Normandy in World War II, the Americans used 11 by 14 Deerdorfs.
Imagine a camera that looks like this, just twice the size.
Yep.
Now, what's the smallest that you could have
4x5. This one folds up to a box about 12 inches square. The smallest one that we make folds up to a box about 9 inches square.
Mm-hmm. See, because I remember a camera that we used to have that had the billows, mm-hmm. and had that look about it. So I couldn't tell you what type of, you know, who it was, but it makes me wonder now.
Well, some of the early cameras had billows, just even though they were very simple designs, just always film and lens perfectly perpendicular, just cameras that you would use for vacations for families. These are a little bit unique in the fact that you do have the ability to do the what are called camera movements, contortions is what I call them. For example, if you hold up the magazine there, you see that View Camera Magazine has Ansel Adams' picture on the front. Everyone's heard of Ansel Adams, a landscape photographer. Well, to a landscape photographer, if you tilt the lens, so I'm tilting this board forward so it's no longer parallel, I'm tilting it forward. By doing that, you can achieve an effect where the closest flower and the farthest mountain are both in focus at the same time. So landscape photographers like these. Architects like them because another example of how you use these cameras is if you look up at a building and your building is here. Your lens and your film are parallel, but they're not parallel to the building. And so then what you get is an image of the building that's trapezoid shape. It distorts the look of the building. With a camera like this, you tilt up and look at the building. You tilt the lens board so that now it's parallel to the building. And then you tilt the film so that it's also parallel to the building. And you're looking at this thinking, but how does the image hit the glass? It's off center. It still works. But what you get by looking up and still keeping everything parallel is before the photographer's eyes, they see the building straighten up and all the lines are parallel as they should be. So for architectural photography, there are things you can do with a camera like this that you really can't do any other way.
So this is not a camera that I guess your amateur photographer is going to go out and get. I mean, this is something you have to know the tricks. I mean, you have to actually know photography.
Yes.
Well, it's a specialized field. There are things about using a camera like this that are identical to anything anyone else could do. For example, you still have ASA. You still have film sensitivity, light sensitivity. You need to know how to use a light meter and choose your settings. The shutter speeds, the f-stops are going to be identical to what you'd use on an Nikon. Where the differences come in are, again, understanding how to use the camera movements, And of course you have a very large piece of film which you load into a holder like an x-ray plate holder. And another thing different about these cameras, when you focus and you look on this 8x10 size glass, when you look through the lens, there's no prism like you have on the top of an SLR.
Right.
So as a result, what you're focusing on under the hood, just to keep the extraneous light out, when you're looking through the glass, everything you're focusing in is upside down and reversed. So it's partly a matter of learning the tricks, as you say, of how to use the camera. Part of it is just a matter of getting used to seeing the world in a unique way.
I'd say, yeah. Now, what interests you in the company? I mean, you have a background in photography?
Well, I studied photography in the 70s. And went to a college where their primary focus was journalism. And I really wasn't interested in being a journalist, but the professors there were more than willing to let me use their large format, which is what this is. They had large format cameras no one else wanted to use. So I had to teach myself about those very things you were talking about the movements and focusing upside down. So I was teaching myself. And in 76, I traded some equipment for my first 8x10-inch Deerdorf. 8x10-inch Deerdorfs was always the most popular size. And it came to me in not really very good shape. And I thought about sending it back to the person that I'd bought it from by mail. And then the more I looked at it, I thought, you know, it's wood screws. I don't see anything here that I couldn't take apart myself. And I'd already been teaching myself photography, so I thought I might as well teach myself camera repair as well. So I took the camera apart, I refinished all the wood parts, I called the company in Chicago and they gave me some tips on how to do that. I had all the metal hardware replated in nickel and I put it back together and it was a nice camera. And long story made a little shorter, I wound up refinishing and refurbishing these cameras for a dealer out of New York. And that lasted through the 70s and into the 80s. And then in the late 80s, in 1989, the company was purchased and moved to Athens, Tennessee. And that's what originally brought me to Tennessee. And I worked for those owners the 3 years that they were manufacturing cameras here. And then everything kind of shut down again, as we talked about earlier, and were kind of dormant for a long time until opportunity came for us to buy the company again. And my sweet wife, Monica, has been a big help through all the years that we refinished these. And so this gave us an opportunity to do what we love and work together. And there's not a day that goes by that we're not equally busy.
Oh, yeah.
And so now we're to the point where we build and sell new cameras. We refinish, refurbish used cameras. We send parts all over the world. In fact, just last year, we shipped either cameras or parts to about 40 states and about 40 countries. Biggest foreign buyers are in China, Japan, Taiwan, Hong Kong, in the U.S., New York, and California.
Last year, we were nominated for and received for Small Business Tennessee Exporter of the Year.
I was going to ask you about that. I know that you received the award. Let me ask you a question. Do you still have your original one that you bought?
No. Like most photographers, you let things go, and I wish I still had that original camera, but I sold or traded it many years ago. And I have pictures of it, and I have pictures of the refinishing job that I did at that time.
Well, let's continue. We're going to continue. Let's go to a break, and we'll come back, and I've got some more questions. I was trying to hold off because I was wanting to hear the history of it, but I've got some questions about the camera and also about the history still. But folks, we're going to take a commercial break, and we'll be back here in just a few moments, so don't go away.
Town Americana, where trucks are big and bold, and a handshake is firm, and your word is gold. Don Lefford Chevy Buick GMC in Athens is a $2,000 drive. Maybe you're coming from here or here. Doesn't matter. Buying a truck from Don Ledford in Athens will save you at least $2,000. Don Ledford Chevy Buick GMC in Athens, a $2,000 drive worth making.
I'll take that drive every time.
At Crawford Pharmacy, we offer custom compounding. Our pharmacists are known for their attention to detail and unique expertise. So visit us at 2260 Chambliss Avenue, Cleveland, Tennessee. For personal assistance, walk right in or come up to our convenient drive-thru. Crawford Pharmacy, serving our community one person at a time.
Kyle Motors, 802 20th Street Southeast in Cleveland, is the place to find quality pre-owned cars and trucks. Kyle offers on-the-spot financing on all vehicles on the lot. Each pre-owned vehicle goes through a complete inspection to make sure each car and truck meets the Kyle Motors standard. Warranty and extended warranties available on all vehicles. Kyle Motors will sell you a car or truck that you will be proud to drive for many years to come. See Tony, Bill, Dale, James, or David and let them put you in your next quality pre-owned vehicle. Kyle Motors, 802 20th Street Southeast, phone 790-7100.
Are you having trouble filing for disability?
Seems no one is concerned about your pain, the waiting, the denials.
While some representatives will meet with you in court, we will meet with you now to discuss your plan. We'll review with you the same file that the judges will see. Call us now, Social Security Law Center at Logan Thompson.
You're entitled to better.
This segment of Tennessee Valley This Morning is brought to you by Crown Chrysler Dodge Jeep and Ram, located at 511 South Lee Highway in Cleveland and 2120 Chapman Road, Chattanooga. For your next new or previously owned vehicle, make it Crown Chrysler Dodge Jeep and Ram, the better way to buy.
Welcome back, folks, and we're still here with Barry and Monica. We've got many more questions for them, or at least James has. James is always the famous question asker.
I'm always interested in things. Now, we talked about earlier about, you know, could an amateur use this? Now, we don't want to scare amateurs away because it's possible. I mean, a hobbyist, you know, all the way up to a professional level. Kind of explain, I mean, I guess we talked about the techniques, but explain, you know, why this, you know, it could be an amateur. You know, an amateur could actually get it and use it, but also and on into, sure, you know, some professional level ones.
Here's the way I'd answer that question. As a photographer myself, I remember the day when I bought my first Nikon, and I thought, now I'm there. I've got the best camera in the world. I'm going to take the best pictures in the world. And I remember taking, I had a darkroom, and shot pictures with the Nikon and enlarged them to 8x10, and I looked at them, and they were pretty good, but they weren't really as sharp as I'd hoped that they would be. And I would go to museums, I'd look at images in magazines, and my pictures just weren't as sharp as those. So I went back to the lab where I had my film processed, and I talked to the guy that did my film processing, and he said, didn't you used to shoot with a camera that made bigger negatives? And I said, yeah, it was a real heavy, clunky thing. He says, you never go down in format, because once you've used a large piece of film, when you go down smaller, you just won't be satisfied. And I said, so you're telling me then that the larger the film is, better your image is going to be. And he says, yeah, that's what I'm telling you. And that was the day I decided that I really wanted to pursue photography with an 8x10 camera. Now, to answer your question, kind of jumping off from that, there are people like Monica mentioned, Douglas Kirkland, who do portraiture, architectural photography, commercial photography. And to them, this is a tool, the tool of their trade. This is what they'd use every day. But probably half the people, at least, in the world that own Deerdorfs are teachers and truck drivers and plumbers and people of all walks of life. And the difference is that they've either seen in a magazine, they've gone to a museum, they've seen these super sharp pictures, and they've asked someone, how do you get that much detail in a photograph? And when they learn that this is the only way to do that, then they'll invest their money in a camera like this with full intention of just going out and shooting pictures for their own pleasure and their own edification, not to be a professional per se, but they'll work just as hard. They'll have to learn just as much information as a professional. It's just that they're using it more of as a hobby. Now, We haven't talked about the cost of these cameras.
Right.
But that kind of separates out the people that are really serious or not, because as a manufacturer of large format camera, Monica can tell you, all we make are the cameras and maybe accessory backs or lens boards to mount lenses. But when someone goes into this, one of the things that they have to learn is you're going to have to shop around, because you buy the lens from one source, maybe new or used. You buy the camera, new or used. Then you need a tripod to mount it on, because you can't really take pictures with it very easily handheld. A few people do.
But the strap would be pretty large around your neck.
The film holders you have to buy. The light meter you have to buy. And all of these things add to the cost. Now, our cheapest camera, brand new, is about $3,000. And if you were, I just got an email just this week from someone in Holland who saw our website, and we want to talk about that. But he emailed and wanted to know what it would cost to buy the whole package, everything that you would need, not just our camera price, but everything. And we have numbers for that. We have estimates that we can give people. For our smallest camera, you'd spend about $3,000 on the box, and probably another $2,000 buying the other items. It's about a $5,000 package. Now, on the other end, our largest camera, you might spend $7,000, $8,000 for the box, and maybe another $5,000 for the other things, because the lenses for the larger cameras are more expensive right. than they are for the smaller ones. So you're looking at an investment, if you're an amateur, of minimum of about $5,000, maximum maybe $15,000. And it just depends on how big of a negative that you want to make and how many lenses that you want to use and so forth. And you think about that and you think, gosh, that's a lot of money. But then you ask people that own Nikon digital systems and if they've bought zoom lenses and they've bought wide angle lenses and they've bought strobes and they've bought accessories, how much do you have invested in your kit? $5,000. So the money really isn't that different. It's more the focus as a photographer. Are you willing to take the time that it takes to set up this camera? Because you can't do sports with it, not very easily. And are you willing to live with images that are upside down and reversed? If you're willing to pay that price, then your payback in return is images of exceptional quality.
Right.
And then there are people who want to be Ansel Adams. You know, they want to emulate the work that they've seen in other famous photographers.
Well, the thing is, too, a lot of times, you know, like you've talked about the different techniques, you know, shooting the building and landscaping and stuff. I mean, that's done in camera. Nowadays, people take it into Photoshop. And you can look at something and say, you know what, that's Photoshopped. You know that technique. You know, you've got 15-year-old kids that can do that now. But it's you know, this here takes technique. It takes an eye for photography. It takes,
It takes patience,
and it takes to see the finished product. You know, you see, you know what, I've got to do this with it to get this shot. You know, it's done in camera. There's no tricks of it at the end. I mean, he's done this on the front here, simply in camera.
A couple of things about that.
One of the interesting things about these is when you have a sheet of negative that's 8x10, you can blow it up to be a mural.
Wall size,
and it will still be sharp. You take your Photoshop digital picture and you start blowing it up, you're not going to blow it up very far.
Yeah, you start getting that pixelization.
And you get pixelization very quickly. So that's one reason why these cameras are still used. You know, you look at Hardy's, you know, and they have those huge posters. And if you walk up and you look, there's no pixelation in their hamburger pictures. It's because it was shot with a large format photographer. Believe it or not, a lot of your food magazines, they are all shot with large format.
Cookbooks
are always shot with large format to this day.
If you look at an image in Southern Living magazine, let's say, and you can almost read Seth Thomas on the clock on the wall and read Oneida on the fork on the plate, those photographs had to be taken with large format.
I've learned something today.
Going back to what you said, though, one of the company mottos for Deerdorf since 1916 has been make the correction on the negative. And that's what you're saying, is you're going to do enough manipulation of everything when you set it up that you don't really have to Photoshop.
Right.
And speaking of Photoshop, a lot of the effects in Photoshop are designed to emulate the view camera.
Yeah.
When you start talking about taking a building and straightening the lines, those are all programs or filters that are designed to emulate what you can do manually using a camera.
Because
like
you see
this.
Lens flares, you know, different things like that. They say 35 millimeter lens flare. You know, mm-hmm. it's going back to, you know, that's what people want to see, that flare and that, you know, mm-hmm. that shot. We're coming down to a couple minutes. It's gone fast, I guess. Let people know how they can find you, how to get a hold of you guys.
We are at what's called deerdorfcameras.com. That's our website. And
you can email us at info@deerdorfcameras.com. Mm-hmm. You can also call us. Our work phone is area code 423-478-6493. So you can call us or email us or find us on the web. Mm-hmm. We also advertise, if you show again the back cover, we advertise every month in View Camera Magazine. It's a magazine that has a circulation of about 20,000 worldwide, and those are 20,000 people that are all into large format. Mm-hmm. And speaking of the number 20,000, that's about the number of cameras that Deerdorf made since 1916. It's about 20,000 cameras for all that almost 100 years. About 20,000. And today, probably about half of those are still in use. The other half are in grandma's attic and waiting to be discovered and bought and sold on eBay so that people call us and say, I just bought a Deerdorf. Can you make it pretty? And
so, yes, we
so
can.
They're still
yes,
out there.
We can.
Well, Barry, Monica, we are appreciative of you being on today, and we have to have you back too, especially the anniversary coming up 100 years.
3 years.
But yeah, we had to have you back because I think there's a lot of stuff we did not cover. I still had some questions, but we are coming up on our next segment.
Yep.
But we do appreciate you being here today, and we have to have you back. Folks, we're going to go to a commercial break and bring on back our next guest. So don't go away, and we'll see you back in just a couple minutes.
Town Americana, where trucks are big and bold, and a handshake is firm, and your word is gold. Don Lefford Chevy Buick GMC in Athens is a $2,000 drive. Maybe you're coming from here or here. Doesn't matter. Buying a truck from Don Ledford in Athens will save you at least $2,000. Don Ledford Chevy Buick GMC in Athens, a $2,000 drive worth making.
I'll take that drive every time.
At Crawford Pharmacy, we offer custom compounding. Our pharmacists are known for their attention to detail and unique expertise. So visit us at 2260 Chambliss Avenue, Cleveland, Tennessee. For personal assistance, walk right in or come up to our convenient drive-thru. Crawford Pharmacy, serving our community one person at a time.
Kyle Motors, 802 20th Street Southeast in Cleveland, is the place to find quality pre-owned cars and trucks. Kyle offers on-the-spot financing on all vehicles on the lot. Each pre-owned vehicle goes through a complete inspection to make sure each car and truck meets the Kyle Motors standard. Warranty and extended warranties available on all vehicles. Kyle Motors will sell you a car or truck that you will be proud to drive for many years to come. See Tony, Bill, Dale, James, or David and let them put you in your next quality pre-owned vehicle. Kyle Motors, 802 20th Street Southeast. Phone 790-7100.
Are you having trouble filing for disability?
Seems no one is concerned about your pain, the waiting, the denials.
While some representatives will meet with you in court, we will meet with you now to discuss your plan. We'll review with you the same file that the judges will see. Call us now, Social Security Law Center at Logan Thompson.
You're entitled to better.
This segment of Tennessee Valley This Morning is brought to you by Crown Chrysler Dodge Jeep and Ram, located at 511 South Lee Highway in Cleveland and 2120 Chapman Road, Chattanooga. For your next new or previously owned vehicle, make it Crown Chrysler Dodge Jeep and Ram, the better way to buy.
Welcome back, folks, and we're here with our next guest, John Dewey. And John Dewey has some interesting...
he's an inventor?
It's right.
An author now.
An author now.
An author now.
And can grow
celebrity.
Some...
We got newspaper articles.
Yeah, we got a newspaper article.
You know, I admit, I kind of had run into John, I guess last fall.
Right.
Was here on campus. There was a Green Day, or actually some people speaking about green items. You was there. You had a stick. What was it called?
It was called the water stick.
No. It was the burn stick.
Oh, the burn stick. Oh, that was my.
Like a fire starter.
Yeah,
wasn't
it's my
it?
Fire starter. I invented that because I just wanted something that you could carry, keeping your emergency packs or whatever, and you can light it with just about anything.
Well, let's not talk about that yet, because that's really another whole show. Because you've got two or three other inventions we haven't talked about. But today we're here because of the water stick grow system.
Yes.
And that's why I want to have John here for today. We've worked on his website for him. Your ebook is being published right now. And we want to talk about that. But you know, you've brought a lot of stuff here, and we've talked to John, and he'll let John tell. I mean, tell about the water stick, the whole idea behind it, how it come up with.
Okay, well, I invented my fertilizer, the Super 42 Vitalizer, first, and it was the year after I invented that I had, and when I made it, what I would do is I would take my fertilizer and suck it up in this giant animal hypodermic needle. I would suck it up, and then I would take the needle and jam it down into the roots of the plants and push the plunger and go directly to the roots of the plants with this needle. And then the very next year, I got carpal tunnel syndrome in both hands, and my hands hurt so bad I couldn't pull the plunger back. So I came up with the idea for the water stick, which waters and fertilizes your plants right at root level. No matter how deep you plant them, you can water them and fertilize them right at root level, and I found out after using it the first year that it saves you about 75% water. I mean, you only use 25% of the water that you would normally use and the fertilizer, because everything goes right to the roots of the plants. It's better for the roots, because once the water gets to the roots, it goes down underneath and the roots follow the water, which makes your roots grow even deeper. And the bigger your roots are, the bigger and stronger your plants are going to be. And then, like I said, I invented the... My first fertilizer was called Super 42, and this was the original bottle that we had for it when it came out on the market. But I tell people in the book, I give people all full instructions in the book on how to build my water device, the water stick. It's actually the prototype that I had made. And I give them full instructions and full list of ingredients on how to make the Super 42 Vitalizer, which will make the plants grow big and strong. It's a vitamin-based fertilizer, and when you harvest your vegetables, you won't believe how good they taste, because the plants absorb the extra vitamins and it goes into the vegetables that you eat, and it makes them taste so much better. And then the next thing I invented for the garden, this is called bug juice.
Look at that, apple cider.
It looks like apple cider.
We got to bring Joe out here and let Joe taste and let us know which one it tastes like apple cider.
Well, what happened was, for years, I tried to grow eggplants. And even with my water stick and my fertilizer, the bugs would always eat the leaves off my eggplants before I'd ever get the first one off. And in this really old book, I had found this recipe on how to keep fleas off your dog. And we actually used it on one of our dogs for years and years and years, and I don't know why I didn't think of it earlier. I said, I wonder what would happen if I gave that to the plants. And I had to change the formula a bit to get it to work in my water stick. And that year, the first year that I used it, no bugs on the plants. And we had eggplants. And the one of the happy side effects is that some of the vegetables on some of the plants will grow up to twice their normal size. We had eggplants the size of footballs that year. And I used it on one of my Better Boy tomato plants. I'll usually grow at least two. I used it on one just to see what would happen, and every tomato on that plant was 2 pounds or more.
Well, we got some pictures. I mean, we got pictures of the tomatoes. I guess we could roll it here, and it's about a minute and a half of some different pictures of the tomato plants, okay. And different ones. And I guess there you go, and you can talk about it here.
Okay, that right there, that plant is that one was about 15 foot tall. That's the 3 3/4 pound tomato I grew. It wasn't done growing yet. That's some more tomatoes that were growing off the plants. That's a really old photo of me. but you can see I've been doing this for years and years and years. And every time I grow tomatoes, we average 150 to 200 pounds of tomatoes per plant.
Wow.
The biggest plant I ever grew, strangely enough, was actually my very first one. It grew to be 20 feet, 8.5 inches tall, and it put out 372 pounds of tomatoes off of one plant. The smaller tomatoes, like cherry tomatoes, those plants don't grow as high. They usually average somewhere between 12 and 15 foot tall, and we average somewhere between 60 and 100 pounds of cherry tomatoes per plant.
And notice your leaves too, the close-up of your leaves, no bug bites on it.
No bug bites. No, the bug juice takes care of that. And now that I called you the other week, we actually made an addition to the formula. I found out purely by accident, if you give the plants a super concentrated dose of bug juice, which I tell you in the book how to make, the plants love it. I wish I had measured. Oh,
root
there's
system.
That's a root system that where the plant had been dead for 4 months already, and usually the little small veins on that tomato leaf or tomato vine root had already decayed, but it was still almost as long as my arm.
Still vitalized.
but if you take the bug juice and give it in a concentrated formula. I gave it to the plants at 8 o'clock at night, and I happened to go out there at 7 o'clock in the morning, the next morning, and I wish I had measured the plants, because those plants look like they grew 4 to 6 inches overnight. And the little tomatoes and the little peppers that were growing on the pepper plants tripled in size overnight. I was just amazed. And I'd been using bug juice for years and years and years, but I had never given it to the plants in that concentrated of a formula before.
Now, Stacy was talking to you the other day, and you were saying that you've got some plants now, about 5 weeks, and how big are they?
Well, I planted some of the plants at different times in our new garden. The pepper plants are 5 weeks old, and they're just under 3 feet tall, and they're loaded with peppers. If you go to the website, I took some photographs and some videos the other day, and they're loaded with peppers. The tomato plants, they were planted 7 weeks ago, and they are a little over 5 feet tall.
Wow.
And they're big, bushy, and they engulf the cages. I mean, it's even hard to see the tomato cages.
And you mentioned your website. Do you want to go ahead and tell us about that?
It's waterstickgrowsystem.com. And on the website, I tell you all about my different inventions that are in the book. There's going to be some more photographs eventually. There's a bunch of videos there that I've been adding some new videos to it. So you can see now, some of the videos are really old and really poor quality. They were from long before I got hurt, and over at the old house when we used to grow 20 foot tomato plants every year. I mean, every year we would grow 20 foot tomato plants, so that's where you can see some of these giant plants. But like I said, those videos are really poor, but they're the only ones that I had with those tall plants, and I'm not in any shape to grow 20 footers anymore. So,
well, that's another point you bring up. What we can bring up is you don't have to have an acre or a half acre garden with this.
No,
you have you have one probably. What size is the one you've just built?
The one that I have this year is the inner dimensions of it, where I'm actually planting food, is 4 feet wide and 12 feet long, and in that garden this year we planted in the beginning of the year. We've already picked a bunch of the stuff out of it, but at the beginning of the year we started with 2 Better Boy tomato plants, 2 cherry tomato plants, 10 pepper plants, bell pepper plants. Then we had spinach and romaine lettuce. Then there were sugar snap peas, sweet onions, and the little Nolan potatoes, all in a 4-foot by 12-foot section.
And it's a raised plant. I mean, it's a raised bed and everything.
Yes, and it's now over at our old house. I was using oak 2x6s, and we had 6 4-foot by 4-foot raised bed gardens. And this year, I only had enough cinder block to do it. This year, I got these people to come in and build me a raised bed garden. It's actually 2 foot high. And there's several reasons it's 2 foot high. One, the soil over at our new house is so poor. Where the garden sits is the best soil on the property, and there's only 2 inches of soil. Once you get past 2 inches of soil, you hit shale. You can't even dig a hole in it, so hard. So I had them make me a raised bed garden that was 2 foot high. And it actually works out nice, because if you're disabled like me, or if you're elderly, you don't have to bend over as far.
Right.
You can, when you can stand like me, I have no feeling in my lower legs, so I can lean up against it. If I get tired, I can sit up on top because we cement at the top. And then plus the fact, you don't have to bend over. Everything that you're working on is right here.
Or up here.
Or up here, yes.
You got to stretch.
So I do like to, in the book, I give all the directions on how to build both gardens and how to take care of both gardens. This one's really nice. This is actually the nicest garden I've had. I've been having so much fun with this 2-foot-high raised bed garden. I think in the video, the new video I took of the tomato plants the other day, I haven't mulched the garden yet, which I tell people do in the book, but I had done it just because I wanted to see what would happen in this 2-foot-high garden. And there was like one or two little weeds, little grass weeds in this whole garden, and they've been growing for 7 weeks, and it's really nice. And it's so little work. The hardest part is getting them built. Once they're built, it's the easiest garden you'll ever have to take care of.
That sounds like it takes more than enough for a family. I mean, a 5 or 6.
That's what I was thinking.
When I get the money and I can build a second one, then I'll have exactly what I had over the old house, because this one garden that I have is actually like 3 of the ones that I had over the old house. So 2 of them would actually take care of my family just about all year long. We'd be able to grow as many vegetables as I need just in those 2 gardens.
Mm-hmm. And which is, what'd you say, 4x8?
It's 4 foot by 12 foot.
Oh, 4x12, yeah. So that's not very big gardens if you really think about it. I mean,
no.
But it's not about how the size of the garden, but it's the size of the plants, the produce coming from it.
Right.
And now some of the vegetables will grow very big, so, and some of them you'll just get a ton of them. I mean, we used to do it year after year after year, and I was raised on a farm. We did the big, you know, the big road gardens, when I found out about this, when we bought our first house, I started doing these raised bed gardens, and I really liked it. And I said, wow, this is the perfect way to garden. And then I was trying to figure out how to make it better. And that's when I started developing the fertilizers. Like I said, I found out long ago that plants need vitamins and minerals, just like people do. So I spent 5 years going through all the vitamins, all the minerals, so I could make a broad-based fertilizer that would work on any plant. And the plants love it, it is a wonderful fertilizer.
Now, your ebook that you've written, it's uploaded, it's waiting for a lot of vendors. I mean, it's going to be on, I think, ebooks.com, Mobi, Apple, Amazon. I mean, within the next probably next day or so, it's going to be available for people. In that, I mean, you take them step by step. I mean, you show them pictures. I mean, it's a proven method that you've said, you know what, I've done it, I've tried it, here it is, the results. I mean, it's got a lot of pictures in it. I mean, I think it was 79 pictures is what we had put in. Well, so I know there's a lot of pictures in it.
Well, some of them were important, and especially when I was showing you how to build the water stick, because it's not complicated once you know how to build one. But I took that last photo, the very last photo, is of the water stick. Now it's outside the garden, because I was pouring water in it, but I wanted you to see how it actually waters the entire root of the plant.
Right, you had water coming from all directions.
All directions, mm-hmm. So it makes it nice, and that way you can picture it in your head. Oh, wow, that's how this works, and it's nice, and you can use them for years and years and years. Some of the ones that are in my garden now are some of the ones that were first built back in 1995. So, and all you have to do is you take, when you're done at the end of the year, you take them out, you clean them off, you hang them up in your garage.
You even got a method for hanging them. I mean, you showed the method, you just kind of fold it in.
Yeah, just fold it up, hang it up.
And not much room taking up.
Hangs right on a hook, no big deal.
So they're easy to store, they're easy to use. I give you all sorts of methods in the book. Plus, I also teach. I used to do a lot with plant genetics, and it was just a fun hobby. So there's also a fun experiment section in the book. And actually, we pulled those Nolan potatoes here the other week. My wife wanted them, so she said, "I want some of the, I want the potatoes." So I dug them up after 6 weeks, and we actually got out of 8 little sections of potatoes that I had planted in 6 weeks. We got 15 pounds worth of Nolan potatoes. And in that area, I planted some acorn squash. And if anybody who buys the book, if they see this, they're going to know what I'm going to do to that acorn squash. I never did say in the book what I actually used to call them. I used to call them bowling ball acorn squash. So you have to read the book to find out how it works. But I'm going to try some of those experiments on a couple of the ones that I planted in the garden. So that'll be a lot of fun just to see how they turn out this year. Because Everything's new to me in this garden. I was so used to doing it in those short raised bed gardens. But this 2 foot high one has just been, I've been just about tickled to death with this 2 foot high garden. It's just amazing how easy it is to take care of.
Yeah, and your book, I mean, in the book it teaches you what to make all the stuff you brought with you today.
Yes, in the book I teach you, give you step-by-step instructions on how to build the water stick. I give you there's written instructions, there's photographic instructions. Then I also give you the list of all the ingredients to make the Super 42 Vitalizer, and I give you step-by-step instructions on how to make it. And then there's, like I said, I also give you step-by-step instructions and all the list of ingredients on how to make the bug juice. Oh, the reason it's called bug juice is because when my water stick and my Super 42 were on the market, and they were only on the market for a short time before I got hurt, the bug juice was not on the market yet, so we had never properly named it. And I don't even know who gave it the name bug juice. It was either my wife or myself. So we never gave it a proper name, so it just stuck. So we just keep calling it bug juice. But there, all the list of ingredients, step-by-step instructions on how to make it. I will tell you this, do not make it in the house. And do not use your wife's good blender.
You've learned from experience.
No, don't use your wife's good blender or any of the other utensils that you use in there, because she will be mad at you.
And you had some pictures, your spinach. You had your hand, and the spinach was just huge.
Yeah, the spinach we grew this year, it was amazing, because we went out there and I planted the spinach, and I've been giving it the Super 42, and been giving it the bug juice. And now the spinach that I was growing, the variety I was growing, the leaves should have been the size of my palm. But instead, they were bigger than my open hand. Mm-hmm. And if you go to, there's at least one, if not two different videos that show it in there, that they're bigger than my open hand. And the romaine lettuce, if on the one video you actually see some of the romaine lettuce, those romaine lettuce are about this big around and about this tall. So they do grow real, real good in these gardens, and it's been a lot of fun. I am trying to get back into used to doing interviews.
The one
that you're holding is actually the year that I invented the water stick, but this is why this one plant grew so big. Mm-hmm. And it was like the first or second week in July when the guy actually came out to do this interview, and the plant was at the time was 10 feet 4 inches tall, and he did a really nice article on me, but it was the title of the article that I really wasn't looking
at. Well, we got the title here.
It says, Etowah Man, a Tomato Frankenstein.
that's a compliment. I mean, you know, the tomato Frankenstein. I mean, you saw some tomato pictures. They're big.
Yeah. Well, this picture's got him, and he's holding, it looks like a yardstick.
That's a yardstick,
and, you
yeah.
know, and it's still not touching the top of this plant.
So you're talking about 9-10 feet.
Yeah, it's very tall.
It was 10 feet 4 inches tall when he took that photo.
When he took the picture.
And it had already produced a good 100 pounds by the time he had taken that photo.
You should get out there with like a white, like a lab jacket, you know.
Well, actually, I needed that when I had my greenhouse, because eventually I hope to get another greenhouse so we can do our other experiments that I used to do. The first year I had the greenhouse, we actually grew flavored tomatoes in the greenhouse. We had three different varieties. We had a tomato that was a cross between a tomato and a cayenne pepper. It was a hot tomato. And people liked that one. Everybody's favorite was the garlic flavored tomatoes. Everybody loved it. When I was a machinist, I'd take them into work and buy the bags full, and the guys would eat them like candy. They loved them so good. The third one was actually for me, but I didn't like it. It was really awful. I tried a cherry or strawberry flavored tomato, and it was just plumb terrible. but the first two, I eventually want to redo those. Yeah, I want to go back and revisit those experiments and try them again. I had originally invented them Dave Thomas was still alive from Wendy's.
Wendy's, yeah.
And I figured who else would be able to market these any better than Dave Thomas? And that's who I was growing for, but they cost me a fortune at the time to grow. And my wife wasn't very happy about it. And when she saw the electric bill for my greenhouse, you know.
So. Solar panels.
Well, yes, now we have solar panels.
Now I know why you was at that meeting.
You He's trying how to make his wife panels. Happy.
Yeah. And,
yes.
And I want to build at least, I would like to build two more gardens because I want another soil garden to go with the one that I have. And then the third one, I have some plans. I want to make it the outside just the exact same as the other two. But on the inside, it's going to be a hydroponic garden. I want to make a hydroponic garden because I have a new formula that I'm working on for hydroponics that I think would work really well. So I want to be able to build a hydroponic garden in there.
Okay. Yeah. We're down to just a couple minutes. Tell everybody again, website, where to get a hold of you.
Okay. The website is waterstickgrowsystem.com. And the email address is real simple. It's waterstick@comcast.net if you want to email me if you have any questions.
And the name of your ebook that
That would help. It's called The 20-Foot Tomato Plant. And I keep forgetting to say
that.
Yeah,
I've seen that.
We got to have you back on too because, I mean, like you said, you got other inventions that you show and that we talked about earlier. And I know there's probably other stuff you're working on.
But we want him to bring some of his produce.
Produce,
and
we want some of those. Garlic tomatoes, because I like garlic.
Yeah, those are fun, and you'd actually like those. There's a lot of fun experiments in the book. If you want to really mess with your friend's mind when you're having them over, I have the acorn squash experiment. Then there's also the tomato jalapenos. That's a really fun experiment. Instead of a regular green jalapeno. These jalapenos when you do it right, they have these black stripes that come down the sides of them. And when they're ripe and you cut them open in the middle, they have this little tiny infinitesimal little ring of tomato meat on the inside.
Wow.
And then I also teach people how to make probably my best hybrid ever that everybody loves is my garlic spinach. I actually teach people in the book how to make it. It's very difficult to make, but once you make it, you'll enjoy it.
Yeah. Well, John, we are down to just a few seconds left. I guess my request would be to make a BLT tomato. You know, just do the bacon lettuce. You know, then the tomato just tastes like it when you eat it. So that's your request from me.
Oh, okay.
I want a BLT tomato. Well, folks, we do appreciate John for being on here today, and also Barry and Monica. Mm-hmm. And we're out of time, and we'll see you again next Friday.